sitting here at my computer table. I got a woofer sitting here. I've got my Dayton audio test system here. And I'm going to make a video and pull some TS parameters off this driver I just reconed. And I've seen a few woofer building videos, but I haven't seen any of people, making or pulling TS parameters on drivers. So I'm going to make a video about that right here. Now, the woofer is a 15-inch woofer that I built several years back, and built it for my best friend. And of course, we live in Southeast Texas. We were both victims of Hurricane Harvey, and this woofer sat underwater for about 12 days, maybe more. I don't even remember. But surprisingly, it really didn't take any damage. Everything come out good and clean. The only bad thing, or what I thought was bad, was the actual screws that mount the basket to the motor had some surface rust on them. But other than that, I mean, the basket's clean, the motor's clean, the gap was clean. But the old pulp cone didn't like the water, So, time to recone. So, I got it reconed. It's a 220-ounce magnet that I got from Ultra, I think, a long time ago. 12-spoke, 15-inch basket. It's a very common basket. The coil is a 4-layer flat-wound aluminum coil. 3-layer laminate spiders. Nice, heavy, non-pressed pulp cone. It's got 10-gauge direct leads. That's what he wanted. Personally, I think direct leads are overrated. Some people just have to have them. And that's fine. If that's what you want, it's your money, you buy what you want. But I'm going to run this thing on the DATS tester. DATS stands for, or D-A-T-S, DATS stands for Dayton Audio Test System. And this is a V2 version. It's a few years old, but it works great. I think that Dayton has recently released the V3. And unfortunately, I don't know what the differences are between the two. But Dayton's not paying me to make this video. I'm not sponsored by anybody. Or none of that. This is my own personal equipment, and I'm just making a video to share with the community. So that's what's up. But I really think that I'm going to relocate this camera to kind of give y'all a better view of what's happening here. So just give me a minute.
One eternity later.
All right, y'all, I'm back. I got the camera zoomed in on the screen a little bit. I hope that y'all can see it. This old camera that I got is kind of old. It does work. It's going to have to work because it's all that I got. Until I can do better. Anyway, I got DATS pulled up on the screen. And talk a little bit about it real quick. The DATS tester comes with a few items you need to know about. It comes, of course, with the software disk. You just put it in your PC or your laptop or whatever you're using. And just follow the instructions on the screen. It comes with the interface module. This thing plugs into your computer with a USB, and it's got alligator clips on the opposite end. This is what you connect to the speaker. It comes with this 1,000-ohm resistor that you use just to calibrate the unit, and we're getting ready to do that. You will also need to invest in you a gram scale, something similar to this. This would come off of Amazon for like $10. In order to do the VOS calculations, you've got to add weight to the cone, and you need to know how much weight, so you weigh it with the gram scale, so you need a gram scale. But we're going to start first by calibrating the DATS tester, and it's pretty straightforward. I don't know if y'all can see that. Come up here to impedance analyzer. Bring down the menu right here at the bottom. It said test leads calibration. So click that, and it tells you to short the leads together and click OK. So real quick, take the leads, short them like that. Can y'all see that? Yeah. And then you'll click OK. I don't know. There, test is done. Shows right there. 0.3756 ohms, and that's the resistance within the leads. it'll take that number and factor it in when it pulls your measurements so you don't get a false reading due to the ohm or the resistance of these wires. Next, you'll go down to, go back to the same menu, impedance analyzer, go down to impedance calibration. Second from the bottom. Click it. Now, like I said, it comes with its own 1,000 ohm resistor. You can really use any resistor you want, but if you use anything other than what it comes with, you'll have to come right here and type in the resistor value for whatever resistor you decide to use. This one comes with 1,000 ohm. It's a half watt 1,000 ohm metal film resistor. I don't know why it would come with such a good quality resistor just to run a test with, but it does. So clip your resistor in line and then click OK. There we go. Right here in your RA measurement, 999.8 ohms, so right at 1,000. And now, the unit is calibrated and you're ready to use it. But there's one more thing I need to show y'all real quick. So, if you'll give me just a minute, I'm gonna readjust this camera and focus it on the speaker and show y'all something y'all need to know. I'll be back.
2,000 years later.
All right, I got the camera focused in on the woofer. If you notice, I've got it sitting on the speaker basket right here. The basket's upside down, and the woofer sits on top of it. Well, the reason for that is the back plate of this motor is vented. So you need to open those vents or allow them to vent when you're doing your test. Now, the reason I'm showing y'all this is to calculate, to do your calculations for the VAS measurement up top here. It wants to know the diameter of the woofer. So in order to figure that out, you will take and you measure all the way up to the tip top of the surround here at the top. That's called the apex of the woofer, or apex of the surround. So you will measure across the top just like that. And I've got exactly 13 inches. So when you take that measurement, write it down so you don't forget it. I'm going to pan the camera back around to the screen real quick, and I'm probably going to focus in right here on the box where the measurements are so y'all can see what's happening when I run these tests. But give me a second.
So much later that the old narrator got tired of waiting, and they had to hire a new one.
All right, y'all, I got the camera set up. I got it focused on the right side of the screen because this is where all the measurements show up when you do the test. So I kind of figured that's probably what y'all need to see. And I got everything in place, you know, the program's running, got the unit calibrated. I've got the information I need from the sub in terms of diameter and all that. And all that's left now is to start running the test. So to do that, take your leads. And they're color-coded, so you really can't get it wrong. Red for positive, black for negative. Something else I want to add, the industry standard says that you should run these tests with your coils wired in series, and I recommend that's what you follow. Now, see, I've tried it both ways. I wanted to know, but every time I've tried it both ways, I pretty much end up with the same outcome. The measurements are pretty much dead nuts even, either way, but you know, industry standard is to test with the coils in series, so do that. But once you got everything hooked up, you will run over to the left side of the screen, and there's a button that says measure free air parameters, and you'll use your mouse to click on that. And something else, you know, wherever you're performing this test at, whether it's in your workshop or your house or you've got an office area or whatever, make sure that it is completely quiet. The reason I say that with the woofer wired up to the unit, it's energized, so it pretty much, it's pretty much a microphone. It will pick up sounds. So any kind of background noise, whether it be a fan or air conditioning, you have children running around making noise, dogs and all that shit, they can cause the test to be faulty, give you a false reading. So make sure that your work area is completely quiet. I've already done that here. So I'm going to go over here and click measure free air parameters. It's going to play a sweep from 5 hertz to 20,000 hertz at 1 watt of power. Here we go. There, it did it. I don't know. I'm pretty sure y'all can see that. I don't know. But I don't even know if y'all heard the sweep, though. I don't know if you picked it up. It's real quiet. I've got an ARIA 3.7. FS is 47. QTS is 0.72. QES is 0.85. QMS is 5.01. The LE measurement is 2.07. And if you can see that, you'll notice that it don't show the MMS or the VAS measurement yet. That's because we got to calculate for that and do it in a whole another test. But if you're not familiar with these measurements, I would suggest that, get online. There's a lot of good information about TS parameters. And, look it up. Learn about those measurements and what they mean and how they, they collaborate with what we're doing here. But I will give you a quick and dirty real quick. Up top here, you got your RE measurement. What that is measured DC resistance in the coil. Your FS, of course, most people know what FS is. That's the resonant frequency of the woofer itself, or the moving parts in a free air atmosphere. QTS, QES, and QMS are kind of relative to each other. We're going to start with the QMS, though. The QMS would be your woofer's dampening factor with included mechanical losses. QES is your woofer's dampening factor with included electrical losses. And then QTS is both. QTS is your woofer's dampening factor with all losses included. LE. The LE measurement basically is the amount of inductance in the voice coil. MMS, of course, that's moving mass. And the VAS measurement. The VAS measurement basically, your box, the air within the box has compliance just like the suspension of your woofer. And it creates a load on the cone just like the suspension does. So your box measurement is the amount of airspace necessary to create the same amount of load as the suspension of the woofer. That's when they're equal to each other. That's your box measurement. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to show you how to check for box. You've got two or three different methods up here you can pick from. You've got a test box method, which requires a box. Added mass method, which is the one we're going to use. And the SPO method. I think the added mass method is probably going to be the best one to use. I mean, especially if you ain't got a box. You're doing this for the sake of designing the enclosure, so I would say use the added mass method first. Now, the way that works is it works based off the FS of the woofer, and you start adding weight to the driver and or until you match the resonant frequency of the woofer. So, I didn't weigh any of these parts before I built the woofer. You can if you would like. I would say to assemble the kit first and then weigh it. That way it factors in the weight of all the CA glue that you use to build the kit. But just remember the outer lip of the surround that gets glued to the basket and the outer lip of the spider pack that gets glued to the basket. There's portions of that portion of weight won't be seen by the moving mass because it doesn't move, it's glued down. Same thing with the surround. So I would say if you weighed the kit, and let's say it weighed 320 grams, just an example, I would round that down to 300 grams and start there. take your weigh it out and knock about 10% off of it. And the reason you can get away with doing that is because all the DAS tester wants to see is the vicinity. Add enough weight to get it where it needs to be, and it'll tell you here when it brings up MMS what it's supposed to be. So. So just you just got to get it close, that's all. But that's what we're fixing to do now. So here at the top of the box, it asked you for piston diameter, and we measured that a while ago, which was 13 inches. So you come over here and you type in 13 inches, and you click your add mass method. Now, when you start adding mass, you need to know how much. So what I'm using is I got a few rolls of electrical tape here. I'm sorry, but masking tape. And I estimate that this kit should probably, the MMS should be around 300 grams, roughly. So you turn your scale on and you take whatever weight you plan to use, set it on the scale, and you weigh it. And whatever it weighs, you'll come up here to the added mass method and type that weight in so we can calculate it. I've got 295 grams right here with this tape, so I'll type in 295. Once you do that, you take the tape and you'll set it on top of the woofer. And come across and you'll click the Measure Boss icon. A box will pop up that says add the mass to the driver and click OK. I've already added the mass to it, so I'm just going to click OK. And it's going to play the sweep again, so make sure it's quiet. There we go. MMS 261 grams, that was close. VAS measurement, you just never know until you go to do the test. And the beauty of it is, when you test for VAS, if you don't have enough weight on the cone, it'll tell you. If you have too much weight on the cone, it'll tell you. So it really won't let you get it wrong, you know, which is kind of a cool feature. But let's see, I got an MMS 261 grams and a VAS of 1.5. So this woofer, QTS 0.7. I think this woofer will work good in a fourth order. I think it will. I think it'll work good sealed. Either way. But anyway, that's a little quick and dirty on the DAS tester. And I highly recommend that if you plan to order parts and, you know, build your woofer from scratch or whatever, you know, without these numbers right here, you won't know shit about anything in the enclosure for it. You won't. I mean, you need these parameters right here in order to design a box that's correct for the woofer. So, and I mean, I've built woofers that, you know, parts alone, you know, $700,000 and $800,000 just in parts, and. You kind of hate to, you know, waste that money or destroy the woofer just by guessing how much airspace it needs, guessing what the port volume needs to be, guessing port length and all that crap. No, these numbers will help you do that. And something else I would suggest, too, is when you get your woofer built, I would hook it up in a free air atmosphere and just run it at low volume, let it move a little bit, and let it play like that for an hour. I mean, I got access to some Pro Audio amps out in my shop that just plug in the wall. You know, I got a 1500 watt Crown D-Class amp right now. And I wire the woofers in series for 4 ohms because that's all them amps run. But I mean, and then I play the sweep on the USAC disc. You know, that sweeps, I think it's track 19, but it sweeps all the way down to 20 hertz or whatever it does. Anyway, and I just run the volume up a little bit and let the woofer move. You know, you're not trying to see how loud it gets. You just want to put some run-in time. I don't like saying break-in because that gets some people in their feelings and shit. But just run the woofer in a little bit. Put a little time on the suspension, soften it up, because I promise you, if you run a brand new woofer on DATS and then break it in or run it in a little bit and soften that suspension up, run it on DATS again and you're going to get a complete different set of numbers. So I would suggest always hook the woofer up at a low volume and let it play for a little while. Put some running time on it. But anyway, that's all I got, people. I appreciate y'all checking me out. And if you like the video or you want to see videos of other stuff, you can comment here or you can hit me up on Facebook. And give me the old thumbs up and subscribe if you like. And once again, I appreciate y'all checking out the video. Your boy, the Deuces, I'm gone.